channel Talk With Rooks, and today I'm here with one of my friends, Kemi, and we're going to talk about the whole sickle cell anemia. She's a sickle cell carrier, and I'll get back to you.
Hi guys, I'm Kemi Balogun. I'm a journalist. I've been a journalist for the past 3 years. It's pretty exciting because being like an adventure for me. Growing up with sickle cell anemia was a bit confusing. It was something that I didn't know at the time, and all I knew was that I would wake up with pain, excruciating pain, something that was changed. It would all be a trigger. Change of weather, change of environment was a trigger. Any small thing that was changed would all be a trigger. Even when I'm excited, it's a trigger. Hey, Christmas, so it can be a trigger. The thought of traveling, trigger, and private life. Balancing work and private life has been as much as I can. I don't, you know, try to mix my private life with my professional life, because it's, you know, sometimes I can't. So it's best you go in, everyone knows your name, everyone knows your job description, you're doing what you can do and leave the rest. When they do have insurance for it, they always ask for genotype and everything. So when they see that you have, you know, sickle cell anemia, they know that your own hospital visit is going to be a bit regular. So it helps to, you know, get that that across to management that will be able to see there. But it hasn't caused any stigmatization or anything per se at work. But it's just, I'm a bit careful, like what I do, where I go to. As much as I'm older, I still live with my parents. I'm almost very far away from them. Like, if I have to travel, I would like it to be somewhere close. I don't want to end up somewhere that I'm alone. Exactly. Because sometimes, you know, when you get crisis, if I don't work, you can't even talk. Like, the pain is so intense, you can't do anything for yourself. So, what I try to do is just avoid stuff like that. I'm usually lucky enough to have people to who understand our work when I'm sick. The days I need to get better, I always give in. And once I'm down, they know that okay, I'm having crisis and stuff like that. So it's been pretty okay. So far, I've never worked in like the headquarters of the offices, always, you know, the utility offices, so where you can, you know, either get time off without, you know, in case of emergencies and stuff. So it's been okay for me. I would advise that once you know your body, you know your body type, you know your genotype and everything, you try and take it easy. You try and explore if you want to, but don't, you know, push it so far, because I mean crisis can get really, really bad to the extent that there will be no control anymore. So just, even if you explore, know the basic things to do, the whole water thing, always hydrate yourself. Always hydrate yourself. Once you hydrate yourself, the chances of getting crisis is really minimal. So keep rehydrating, then always carry meds, even if it's just normal painkillers, ibuprofen and stuff like that, so that you just have something when you need it to ease the pain a bit before you get medical attention. And also, as teenagers, as you're growing up, still remember that you know your genotype, you know who to marry, who to end up with. Be very critical about it. Don't always dive into relationships that you know would even make you sicker than you were before you entered.
Yeah, because there's some relationships that will affect you psychologically. Yeah. And you're falling ill. You can do everything, but the fact that your mind is not pressed.
The thing is that when you even get into relationships, make sure you are with someone who supports you, someone who really cares, and yes, who understands, who is willing to either learn or willing to you know, just be with you through the process. It really, really helps. And in fact, for even in life partners, that's just the best thing that you can do for yourself.
And please, if you meet someone that runs away from you for the fact that you're a sickler, just let the person go. It doesn't matter.
Don't force it.
Just let the person go, because the person is not worth it. Otherwise,
you'll
be unhappy, because anybody can actually run away because they're a sickler. Come on.
Me, it's just a myopic way of thinking.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, at this time and age, you should know. All the person needs is care. And there are people who are out there who will not even care
what,
you know, shape your your genotype is, they want you as a person because of what you are, or I mean, or how you are, and everything. So it's there's no need stressing yourself through looking for someone who's the person that will want you.
This is our life, this is what we are, we can't change it.
We can't do anything about it, and even now with new stem cells research and stuff, basically it works for people who are probably very young, if you realize
success is higher.
So even for me now, unless if I just want to waste my time or explore, that's when I'll even consider it, because I think my life is fantastic. Right? My life is okay. So I'm okay. I don't sit back and regret anything. I had a childhood. I had fun. I did what I was supposed to do at the time I was supposed to do it, even though it was it rushed me to the hospital. But
yeah,
I still did it.
And wild child.
So it was, and it, I mean, if you, like sometimes, even now, I will sit back and say, you think I think I'm supposed to say I'm very fat, or I will not, you know.
You're not fat.
I want to have some little money. So I'll be, because all my siblings are, we are normal. We have two hands, two legs.
Exactly. It's just that, yeah. Health-wise, sometimes we get really bad.
Yes. And hospitals, we need to, I don't know what we can do about hospitals.
I'm telling you, I don't know what we can do.
The issue is really, because for me, I believe that sometimes people who have sickle cell anemia end up in the hospital, but they still die because of this or poor treatment. And people, the thing is, nurses and doctors, I used to wonder, like, how did they read about sickle cell anemia? Because they should know the excruciating thing that we go through. But you'll be seeing them telling you.
Or they don't get trained well in medical school.
I don't understand. You'll see them say, okay, we're giving you a dose of this thing, this painkiller, and then we'll give you another one 12 hours later.
Like,
this thing will work for 30 minutes. It will kill my pain for 30 minutes.
I think what's better, when you now tell them 12 hours, like, hey, you're addicted.
Yes.
They think sickness are addicted.
We just want to be popped up with the more the better. We want to be high all the time. Goodness gracious. Even though there's a little, maybe 1% of people who live with sickle cell anemia get addicted, because the pain they go through makes them addicted. They just don't want, they want to be numb. They don't want the pain at all. They want to be numb throughout. Even if the pain comes or whatever, they are still numb. That is it. Because the pain we go through cannot be explained, though. It can't. So I don't know why, you know, people who are supposed to have sympathy for people who go into the hospital and they are in pain, you still be, you know, looking at us as if we just came to get them. If I wanted to get shots of stuff, we'll know where, I'm not going to the hospital.
Exactly. I'm sitting down there, I'm telling them to give us something. And then, at least parents, I know it's very difficult, but you guys have to be really patient.
Yes.
I don't blame the child all the time, because all the time it's not our fault. It just comes when it wants to come. It's not our fault. Like, we can do everything right.
Yeah. So
we can.
Then this, palindrome, I think.
You take palindrome.
It's difficult for me to.
Palindrome is for malaria.
It is. But the issue is, when I remember when I started taking palindrome, this was like many years ago. When I started taking palindrome, it was making me get sick. So what is this? Everyone is different, body types and everything. So it was making me get sick and everything. So every time you go to the hospital and they announce it's malaria, that is triggering your crisis. You don't take palindrome, you don't do this, But yeah, like, you know, if it makes me sick, I can't force myself to, you know, keep taking it. And the thing with palindrome is, the moment you stop it, or you don't take it for a while, then you will now fall sick in the end. Yeah. And then there are people out there who really cannot afford it, because palindrome is very expensive. So people cannot constantly afford to be taking palindrome. But each right, you should eat the right things as well.
Yeah.
And alcohol is off limits too. Because
some, I know that there's some sickle cells that actually drink and smoke just to take their mind off it. It's not good though.
Yes, so.
But if it makes you happy.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, enjoy yourself.
Just avoid things that stress you out and make you fall sick. As long as you know your body.
Do whatever makes you happy. Seriously, like your mental state is really very important. Whatever makes you happy, man. If it's playing games, if it's swimming, if you don't fall sick, you're having to swim. If it's gisting, if it's watching movies, anything, do it.
Because
to make you feel better.
Exactly. Because for your sake, you have suffered a lot. You keep suffering. So it's best to make yourself happy while you can and enjoy your life.
Yeah.
And then if you have a friend you can always talk to, if a friend that is very supportive, it's good to have someone who will always be there for you, so that even when you're in crisis or you're stressed up or whatever, you let it out and that person is always there, like someone you can rely on.
And pick your friends.
Yeah.
You need good friends, you need reliable friends, you need friends that you can always call on. Just imagine being in a place where you don't really have family, you don't really have family members, but you have that one friend that you can even call like 1 a.m. and the person will run and come and pick you up and take you to the hospital. Or stay with you and help manage your pain until it's time to leave the hospital.
And a friend that understands your situation, obviously. Yeah. He's a friend, the person will
understand. And any friend that you see that is bad, please do it with the person.
You don't need the extra baby.
Mental state is key. Mental state is key. Alright, Kemi, thanks so much.
You're welcome.
Please share, subscribe, and like. And I'll see you guys next week. Bye.
Bye.